to live, things that can help decrease your inflammation and pain. So we are very excited to be able to welcome her today to share with us. We want to especially thank our series sponsor, Bertram Hills, for their generous support of the series, making it possible. And just one quick reminder, if you are planning to come next week, it would greatly help us if you could RSVP on our website, just so we can make sure that we have adequate seating and space for everyone. Emily is a registered dietitian with Sparrow Health System. She's been working at the hospital for 15 years. Emily received her bachelor's degree from Michigan State University and her master's degree from Central Michigan University. She is very interested in nutrition's role in health and prevention. Some of you may remember Emily from several years back, 2 years ago actually. She presented as part of our senior health system, senior health series, excuse me, on memory care and aging. So please join me in welcoming Emily this morning.
Thank you very much, Katie. So like Katie said, I'm super excited to be here, and I feel very passionate about nutrition and our health, and this topic of anti-inflammatory diet. It's perfect for arthritis, but it really is just should be incorporated in all of wellness. So I think we're going to get started. I have a PowerPoint planned. I would like to keep it more casual, but I think we've got a very large group, so we'll kind of hold our questions until the end. And I'm going to try to give 15 or 20 minutes at least for questions. Okay, so I'm going to start off, and our topics are going to be prevalence of arthritis and the types of arthritis, but I'm actually going to skip through those. Katie explained that you guys have had lots of speakers and have gone through osteoarthritis versus rheumatoid and all the different ones, so I'm going to skip it because you guys, I'm sure, are very knowledgeable on that. We're going to really focus on the anti-inflammatory diet, antioxidants, supplements, how the whole Mediterranean diet fits into that, and keep it applicable with recipes and sample meals. So prevalence, I will just quickly look at this slide. 1 in 5 people will be affected by arthritis in their lifetime, and that's according to the National Institute of Health. So like I said, I'm going to skip the types for a moment and go right into the anti-inflammatory diet. So this diet, just in general, can lower blood pressure. It protects against conditions such as cancers, strokes. It helps to lower inflammation, so it's really a great match for arthritis. It benefits your joints and your heart, and it can help with weight loss. If you're eating less processed foods, the goal would be weight loss if you need to have, if you need, your body needs weight loss. So fish, I've got like a little cartoon here. It's kind of hard to read, but the guy says to the server, yeah, my doctor says I should eat really, really greasy fish. So I'll have your deep fried seafood platter. And I think sometimes, you know, we think of fish as a great thing, but we forget preparation affects it too. So I thought that was cute. But seriously, fish is really great for us. A serving size of fish, and these are all like the key points in anti-inflammatory foods. So fish, when I think of inflammation, I think about protecting that with omega-3s, which come from the fish. So a serving would be 4 ounces. I usually tell people 3 ounces is about the size of your palm. So maybe a bigger palm is a serving, and a couple times a week. I'd love to suggest fish all the time, but there is always the concern about mercury with fish. So you gotta be a little bit careful, but I personally love fish. The ones that are highest in omega-3s, salmon, that's pretty much what everybody thinks about. Tuna though is great, like light tuna. Herring, anchovies, and scallops are also wonderful if you like those too. So some of you may have the question, should I have supplements? And that's a great question. There's a lot of studies, you know, talking about taking a gram of fish oil a day and to see if, you know, inflammation was improved. This is a study using one of the, fish oil has two main fatty acids. I'm not even going to try to pronounce it. It's like docohexaenic. I'm terrible at pronunciation. And the other one is EPA. So there's DHA and EPA. This study was with DHA, and the source wasn't fish per se. It was a type of algae oil that had omega-3s in it. And the result, if they did 2.1 grams a day, now that's not of the whole supplement. So any of you familiar with like a capsule of fish oil? That's a gram, but roughly only half of that would be DHA. You'd have to look at your label. I have one at home that there's a teaspoon is the amount, and one teaspoon is 500 milligrams. So as you can tell, this is quite a bit. I don't know how much it was. It depends on what brand they chose, but they took more than one capsule to get this, 2.1 grams of the specific DHA. And these were patients that had rheumatoid arthritis. And the results were less swollen joints, and their inflammatory labs, perhaps their CRP, was improved. So that was a study in 2017 that was done. I think fish oil is great. You should always mention it to your doctors because it is a potential blood thinner. So we're going to move out of fish. So fish is great. Get your fish in. And then if you're thinking about supplements, I think the bottom line is mention it to your doctors. See if they know of any studies for your particular arthritis or other health concerns. So nuts and seeds. Nuts and seeds are a great snack. Another anti-inflammatory food. A handful is about an ounce and a half. You know, it just depends. Like I know one time I measured almonds and it was like an ounce of almonds was like 20 or 24 almonds. So we're just gonna say a handful of nuts. Walnuts in particular, that I always think of omega-3s and walnuts. It's one of the few foods that aren't fish that are high in the omega-3s. Walnuts are the highest, but I've read that pine nuts, pistachios, almonds also have some omega-3s in it too. So there was a study done in 2011. And those that consumed the most nuts had a 51% lower risk of morbidity from an inflammatory condition such as rheumatoid arthritis. So a great snack to potentially protect you against inflammation. So nuts are a monounsaturated oil, super good for the heart. They can help with weight loss. They fill you up. There's lots of fiber. So it's just a great snack for anybody. So another group of anti-inflammatory foods is fruits and vegetables. It's crazy, but really the recommendation is like 9 a day. Years ago, the cancer, from what I remember, I don't know if it was the American Cancer Research or just the Cancer Society recommended like 9, and I remember thinking, gosh, I think 5's a lot. But 9 is really a lot, and it's really been proven to help with inflammation because of those antioxidants in it. We consider a cup most of the time about a serving, but if you're going to have something that's more airy and takes up more space, such as like lettuce, you may need a couple cups for a serving. So a lot of your diet is going to be fruits and vegetables if you're trying to get the 9 in a day. So lots of antioxidants, helps your body's immune system, its natural defense. If you've ever heard of free radicals, which we're trying to prevent, that we get from the environment, and lots of other ways that fruits and vegetables can help us neutralize those. Specific antioxidants, the anthocyanins, I always think of the red ones like cherries, the purple and red skins, berries, citrus is high in high in vitamin C, but it's also high in antioxidants. And then we also don't want to leave out melons. Melons have tons of antioxidants in it. But some of the greens would be broccoli and spinach, lettuce, kale, cabbage, and they're also high in vitamin K too. So lots of fruits and vegetables in your diet. And we're going to get into the Mediterranean diet so you can kind of get an idea of how to make that work. So olive oil, a great monounsaturated fat for your heart. The particular component called oleocanthal, it's kind of interesting. Studies have compared this, I believe it's an enzyme, to like ibuprofen, the way it kind of acts in your body as far as helping with inflammation and maybe a little bit with pain and your how your body perceives pain. So it's kind of interesting. So, and you want to most of the time choose extra virgin olive oil for its purity and it's less refined. If you want to though, avocado is a great source of monounsaturated fats. Safflower oil can help with reducing your cholesterol. And remember we talked about walnuts. Walnut oil has 10 times the omega-3s as olive oil. Mm-hmm. Olive oil is not necessarily high in omega-3s, but it's got some other components to it. So yeah, I need to try walnut oil a little bit more. I've been trying to do more with avocado oil, like I've chosen a mayonnaise that had it in it. So trying to be a little more creative and brave with that. But walnut oil, I imagine it would have a really nice nutty texture and be good. So beans, the magical fruit, lots of fiber. You know, we're gonna talk about the Mediterranean diet. It doesn't focus on meat. You've got to get the beans in. So fiber, it fills you up. It can help lower the CRP. That's the C-reactive protein. That's a blood marker of inflammation. So we want that level to be as low as possible. Lots of protein in beans, up to 15 grams a cup, like in a black bean. So red beans, pinto beans, black beans, you know, get your beans in. If you're making tacos, substitute the beans for the meat, or sometimes I just do half and half, just so you're still getting a little bit of that meat, but also getting the beans in too. So they're great for you. Chilies, we're unfortunately coming into fall with all those warm foods. So here's a good reason to keep those in your diet. Whole grains, excellent for, again, for fiber, for lowering the CRP, whole wheat flours, including pastas, brown rices, quinoa. Anybody try quinoa? Yeah, it's acquired, but it's a great grain. Now, some people with inflammation have done experiments or know that they're sensitive to gluten. Of course, if that's your case, obviously to avoid the actual, like, the whole wheat, but you can still have quinoa and oatmeals. And there's some other grains out there too, that chia and all sorts of things. Well, that's more of a seed, but ways to get the fiber in and whole grains. So there was a study that showed up to 50% lower CRP, again, that's that C-reactive protein blood test, for people that ate 30 grams of fiber a day. And that actually is the recommended 30 grams. It's quite a lot, but people, they lost weight with the high fiber, and they had their balance of the mono and polyunsaturated fats was much better, less saturated fats. So it was a better heart fats too. So fiber really can help with inflammation, which is all goes back to arthritis. And that was an article from 2009. Nightshade vegetables are kind of interesting. I always think, I think it's tomatoes and eggplant, peppers too, and regular potatoes. There's got lots and lots of antioxidants in them. But there's like mixed studies to show if it makes symptoms worse or it makes it better. So I just thought I'd throw it in there because I've had questions on those before. So if you can eat eggplant, you go ahead and make lots of eggplant parmesan. But if it bothers you, perhaps you're sensitive to the nightshades. I got another little comic for you just to break it up. So this two kids are talking at the lemonade stand, and he says, "I'm just telling everybody the punch is full of antioxidants." So it's true. We all love that. I mean, that's a word that we're used to hearing, and lots of research on its benefits. So we'll kind of continue to move on. We're going to talk again, just kind of focusing on the antioxidants. And I'm starting with selenium, which is a micronutrient. And some studies have shown that people with rheumatoid arthritis have lower levels than normal of this mineral. But it's really important with inflammation, and some really good sources the best source actually is Brazil nuts. Anybody know that? One nut, I think, essentially has like 100, one or two nuts has 100% of your value. But there's some in whole grain products, yellowfin tuna, certain fishes. It's dependent on the soil. I did a study, or I did a review one day in college, or one semester in college, and it was reviewing the soils. I think Michigan has okay soil, not great. So it's dependent on the soil, but for sure those Brazil nuts have an excellent source. So just something to think about for selenium. Carotenoids, another great anti-inflammatory, but antioxidant. And it can, these include beta-carotene and beta-cryptoxanthin. And examples of beta-carotene is that orange color. So you're gonna think melons, sweet potatoes, pumpkins, carrots. It's also in kale, which doesn't have the color, obviously. But butternut, squash, and then spinach, again, another green one. People that have high levels of the beta-cryptoxanthin were half as likely to develop inflammatory arthritis. So adding just one serving of the foods I mentioned, the squashes, permissive, that's always a cute word, those fruits. I see them all the time. I've never actually prepared them, but some of these orangey type fruits, including tangerines, red peppers, you've got this on your list, oranges and apricots can really help with actually preventing inflammation, inflammatory conditions such as arthritis. So vitamin C, another antioxidant. We know a lot about vitamin C, but again, it was it reduces a good diet, and vitamin C reduces the risk of arthritis. So good examples, I think of citrus, tropical type fruits, oranges, guava, peppers, strawberries, pineapple, even broccoli, kidney beans, and cauliflower. But research shows that high doses from supplements can really actually be negative for people with osteoarthritis. So don't go overboard on that. So pomegranate, that's such a fun fruit. A lot of people consider that a holiday fruit. They may add it to a sparkly drink or make other festive dishes with it. But it's rich in polyphenolic compounds, and they're anti-inflammatory, good antioxidants. And there's actually been studies on this using the extracts and reducing inflammation in people that have rheumatoid arthritis. And that was done in 2016 in a study. So just another reason to try some pomegranate juice, or actually the fruit itself. Green tea. I already had a question about this, and I think this is a great green tea is just so good for you. It's got the EGCG antioxidant in it, anti-inflammatory. It can reduce some inflammatory markers in people with arthritis, and it can preserve your joints. And my question I got earlier was, well, how about black tea? And I was like, I agree with you. I love black tea. I want some milk in it and a little honey, and it's very comforting, or some iced tea. I think black tea has a lot of great benefits, but I think the specific antioxidant with inflammation is going to be much richer in the green tea. But, you know, in the summer, you know, we're always looking for different ways, at least I am, to get our fluids in without, you know, drinking just water or choosing something sugary. So I recommend, I like to brew green tea. So maybe I don't like it hot, but brewing it and drinking it cold is just a nice option to kind of flavor your water and, you know, get some of the antioxidants in there. So lots of green teas out there. My favorite is the ones that are mixed with mint. There's a certain one out there with a little mint in it too, and it's very refreshing. So play around with some green teas if you're in the mood. So spices, antioxidants and spices. So turmeric or curcumin are very powerful, very well-known antioxidants, and very high in anti-inflammatory properties. So a study in 2006 showed that that the turmeric was better at preventing the inflammation of the joints. It was better than actually, it didn't maybe reduce. If you already had the joint inflammation, it didn't do quite as good of a job, but if you were trying to prevent it, it was definitely something beneficial. But it's not gonna hurt you either way. So ginger is another antioxidant that helps with pain and inflammation. So play around with some of these spices. I actually recently tried to get, you know, how can I use turmeric? I don't, you know, normally use it. And, you know, I looked online and found a nice, it was a rice-based recipe and it was vegetarian. And this one had nutritional yeast and it was a lot of different things, but it had the turmeric in it and it was very tasty. And I knew that it had a lot of benefits of anti-inflammatory benefits. So, but I'm going to talk about some recipes at the end with you. So supplements. So many people who have arthritis have tried glucosamine and chondroitin. So that, I'm gonna kind of, you know, research is pretty split on it. It may be helpful with preserving collagen. Most of the time when I talk to rheumatologists or doctors, and I ask them, like, what are your feelings on it? They say, try it, and if it works, great, if not, it's not harmful. I don't have a ton of research, but I wanted to bring it up because we get a lot of questions on it. So if you're on it now and you feel like it's beneficial, that's great. If you don't, it may not be. It just seems to only work for certain arthritises and certain people. And the combination, you know, is different too. I can share some, if anybody has specific questions, I can share some research I've done in it. So, you know, some look at the combination, some looked at them individually, but the bottom line is it was very individualized, the results. This is a study of 1,500 men and women who had knee osteoarthritis, and they took 1,500 milligrams of glucosamine, 1,200 of chondroitin, and they also took celecoxib. I know it's an NSAID drug. It's an anti-inflammatory type drug. I'm not really familiar with it, or a placebo. The combination did not effectively reduce pain, but the combination, in some cases, was better. I don't know. That's what. The combo was the best for moderate to severe knee pain. So it had a little bit of benefit with the combination. But so you had to talk to your doctor about the dose. And again, this was a pretty long study too that they were on it. So vegetarian and vegan diets, they can be really beneficial. I've got somebody who I'm close with that totally believes in with inflammation and. Not a vegan diet, but a vegetarian diet. It works really well for her. But this is a study of 600 participants in 2015 that did a true vegan diet for 3 weeks. That means no animal products whatsoever. And they had a reduced CRP, the blood inflammatory marker. So that was really hopeful. Then another group did for 3.5 months, they did it and they had improved symptoms. Then they transitioned into a lacto vegetarian diet and the symptoms continued. So the lacto means they added milk to it. They didn't say that they added egg, they didn't say they added fish, but it sounds like after you know are strict for a while, there's hope you can add a little bit more in. But like I said, one of my colleagues does really well with just vegetarian, where she does fish, eggs, and milk. So give it a try. So now we're going to kind of go into putting this all together, the ultimate arthritis diet, and really a diet for, I can't think of one, very few people that wouldn't benefit from a Mediterranean diet. You've probably all seen this pyramid before. At the bottom, of course, lifestyle, where they're, you know, active, showing people being active. But at the bottom, it's whole grains and tons of fruits and vegetables. You move up, and you're allowed to have, I'm just going to switch my icons, you can have fish 2 times a week, and you can have eggs and chicken no more than once a day, but they'd rather you space it out a lot. And then it's very low, and I think it's almost no beef, and very little sweets, and basically it's no processed food. So it's whole food based, and you can see the little icon on the left, for those of you that like wine, it's allowing a little red wine in moderation and lots of water. So there's some perks to it too. So when people actually adhere to the diet, means they followed it really, really strictly, they had a better quality of life, less pain, disability, and it even helped with their mood. And that was a study in 2016. Again, it was all about adherence, because it's not hard to say you're on a diet, but the people that were super strict, that could submit the food logs, really showed the biggest improvement with their health. So what would you eat if you're on a Mediterranean diet? So I just put together some ideas that we can kind of brainstorm later. Examples of a breakfast would be, again, dairy is allowed on the diet. Greek yogurt, super high in protein. So maybe a Greek yogurt layered with some whole grain oats and some strawberries for breakfast. Lunch could be a whole grain bread, like a sandwich, but actually vegetable based. So maybe you grill up some mushrooms or maybe a little cheese on it, but really based on maybe something with hummus, but whole grains and vegetarian. Dinner could be a tuna salad with olive oil and a piece of fruit. Another day, oatmeal with raisins. The leftover tuna salad from the night before. Or, I was just thinking, something I made this week, it could be simple, like beans and rice, taking whole grain rice, you know, having beans. It's not hard. I really forget how comforting that meal is, and it can be super simple and very filling and just excellent match of proteins. Dinner could be, this is, you know, a salad. If you hadn't had your two, I guess, trying to watch how much fish we're having, but a salad, maybe some chicken if you haven't overdone it, with lots of vegetables on it and some feta cheese. Wednesday breakfast could be an omelet made with vegetables, including tomatoes, onions, fruit to go with it. Lunch could be another whole grain sandwich with cheese and some fresh vegetables in there. Dinner could be making like a Mediterranean vegetarian, basically a vegetarian lasagna. Maybe spinach based, not too heavy on the cheese, lots of vegetables. Sounds really good. Thursday, back to yogurt again, but you could add fruit and nuts this time, add those walnuts for the omega-3s. Lunch could be, you know, leftovers, but I don't see why even like a peanut butter sandwich would be okay on whole grain bread. Maybe a nice vegetable soup that you put together. I'm going to take a real quick survey. Anybody using the Instant Pot at home? Mm-hmm. Not really? Yeah, a couple of you. I'm going to start getting into it, but that's a great way to make, you know, beans. You can make even dry beans in just minutes, which to me that takes like a day. You have to like soak them and then, you know, cook them the next day. People say it's taking minutes to do that, but I was thinking making a vegetable soup, even if you took frozen like soup vegetables, made a tomato-based or a broth-based broth, and you might be able to put that in your Instant Pot and have that done in half an hour. Dinner could be a broiled salmon with brown rice and vegetables. Friday would be oatmeal again with nuts and apples and raisins. Back to our, we gotta get more creative with this one, back to our vegetable sandwiches. How about an eggplant parmesan? That would work. Mediterranean pizza with whole wheat crust, cheese, vegetables, and olives. Saturday, another eggs with vegetables and olives. Wednesday, we got lunch as our leftover day. Dinner could be grilled chicken, maybe with kebab, like a chicken kebab with vegetables, maybe a little potato roasted, and fruit for dessert. Sunday could be lots of eggs. Your eggs, using olive oil to cook them in, Greek yogurt with oats and nuts, grilled lamb with salad and a baked potato. So, you know, you're getting good protein in, but you really got to push those fruits and vegetables. I made a little snack sheet too, using nuts, sipping on green tea, berries all the time, oranges, yellow peppers with a hummus dip, and cantaloupe. So those are just some ideas. So this is more of our practical time. So let me get some of my recipes out that I wanted to show you. So these are two examples of fairly easy recipes, and I think perhaps in the future we're going to work with you, or some of our other dietitians are going to work with you guys on actually making these recipes either here or at Sparrow. So stay tuned for that. But this is, I hope you have this attached. This is a, I'll start with the one on the right. This is an easy Mediterranean chicken. It's chicken breast with a little salt, but you could certainly omit that. Basil, olive oil, tomatoes, and an olive oil tapenade. From my understanding, it's just olives with, is it pine nuts? Oh, no, capers, and olive oil. So it's making like a little, like a little sauce, and for that to give it some lots of flavor. So that would be a pretty easy one pot meal. And the other one is using, it's a tuna salad that's not mayonnaise based. It's using the healthy fat from the avocados. We recently had an event at our demonstration kitchen at Sparrow. We have like a kitchen where we teach, and we made egg salad with avocado, and it was so delicious. Again, it wasn't mayonnaise based, but it had so much flavor, and there's so much good nutrition in avocado. So this would be another way to use your avocados and get those in and still follow a Mediterranean diet. These are some examples of books I found on the internet, just for getting you started on Mediterranean cookbook. I was looking for ones that weren't too, you know, that had relatively limited ingredients. I'm not one when I'm trying new food to have, you know, 30 ingredients. I kind of like it simple and things I can use the ingredients for in another dish. So this one was okay, and this beginner one too had a lot of practical information to get you thinking about the Mediterranean diet and being able to use it at home. Some of my other references from my talks, I gave you a lot of the journals, or at least I can give you more examples of it, but I also used a lot of information from Consumers Lab and the Arthritis Foundation, so I wanted to give them credit. I think I'm wrapping it up with my planned part, but I hope that we have plenty of time. I hope we can spend some time with questions, if that's okay. Yeah. I'll let Katie work on that.
Where do scallops fit in?
Scallops, I mean, great protein. Shrimp and scallops, I'm not aware that they're high in omega-3s. But that doesn't mean that they're not delicious. So, but they would work in the Mediterranean diet because they're fish. Is that what you're asking, or omega-3s?
Just the shrimp count good somewhere?
Yeah, I think, I don't have any, I think they're twice a week, you know, I think they work great. C-reactive protein, and that's an indicator that a lot of doctors use for inflammation, either from our heart or even inflammation I see if you've got like an infection. So it's a blood test that shows your inflammation level, and they can track that. The lower the better.
What was that called?
CRP, C-reactive protein. So a lot of tests will use that as a means to kind of compare results.
We had another question over here.
Yeah.
At the other end of the scale, what should you stay away from?
Great question. That is a great question. The big thing is convenience foods.
Red meat?
Red meat, yeah. So it's just kind of cooking more naturally, using, for lack of better terms, whole foods, and not using things that have a million different hydrogenated oils and heavily processed sugar. That's another thing too. Added sugar. We're not talking about fruit. We're talking about white sugar. Increases inflammation in our body.
We have another question over here.
Yep.
When you talk about nuts, I never see pecans recommended. Why are they never on the list?
You know, they aren't on the list. They must. They're great for protein. They're great for fiber. I get 100%. Maybe they get a bad rap with pecan pie. I don't know. No, I don't know. I'm going to look that up. They've done it. I'm sure they're good for something. They're just not, yeah, they're not heavy in omega-3s for sure. But they would be monounsaturated for sure. So I have cards over here. If you want to take it and you want to pick my brain and send me an email, I'd be happy to look that up for you.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Did you have another question?
Two questions. One, we have tuna in olive oil instead of tuna in water. Why do you recommend the tuna in the oil?
Yeah, that was from the recipe. I don't have an opinion. I think they were trying to get the olive oil in because it's part of the Mediterranean diet. But I would do in water. And the light, actually, from what I read, has less mercury than the white. Light in water.
Does it matter what kind of olive it is? Can it be black, green?
That's a great question. It doesn't specify. I know the green ones are traditional for like the Mediterranean, but I sure love my black olives. So I'm not familiar. I'm not 100% sure. I'm thinking they're thinking more green, but I don't think the black are really good. They're still really high in good fats too.
Another question up here.
Yeah, I wanted to find out about Metamucil as a supplement. I'm on Metamucil every day.
Yeah.
And for fiber.
Yeah, Metamucil is a great source. I believe it's soluble fiber. So, you're trying to get towards that 30 grams, and it's just good for our digestive system. So if it helps you, it's great.
It's good for cholesterol loading.
Yep, soluble fiber kind of forms a gel to help pull out some of that cholesterol.
My other question is jalapenos and cayenne pepper. These neither one were mentioned.
Yeah, they can be very powerful. So yeah, absolutely. If you can tolerate it, yeah. If your family can tolerate it, being around you.
Do you know what the difference is between glucosamine and chondroitin?
I don't off the top of my head. I don't even want to say. I have stuff up here that I'll show you. Is that okay if we look at the research? I know it has to do with where they get it from and collagen, but I don't want to, off the top of my head, I'm not.
Does anybody in here maybe
know? Does anybody have a medical degree or been done enough research on those to know the difference? Yeah. Is there a pharmacist coming? That would be a great
There question. Is a pharmacist coming, so you can hold that question for the discussion panel on September 18th. I got another question here in the back.
The Mediterranean diet is compatible with the diabetic type diet?
That's a great question. It really should be. You're going to have to watch your fruits a little bit, you know. But with the diet, you know, yes, definitely lots of the vegetables, a couple servings of fruit even at each meal. I don't know how specific, if you're counting carbohydrates and all that kind of thing. If you did notice your blood sugar went up, it could be easily tweaked with a visit with a dietitian and still followed. So absolutely. I definitely think it could. It might be something though you'd want to just kind of have a dietitian give you, depending on your weight and what your glucose goals are, give you a number of fruits versus vegetables. But yes, it should definitely work together.
When you were talking about turmeric, you mentioned a rice dish that had nutritional yeast in it. Do you know about the recipe?
No, but I will. Can you take my card at the end? And I'll give you the recipe. I have it at home. I can't remember where I got it from. I think I just got it online. Yeah.
I have two questions. One is, did the benefits of orange carry over to pulpy orange juice?
Oh, well. Yeah, I mean, I think we always say eat the real fruit because it's got the fiber in it. Mm-hmm. I never actually looked at the fiber content of pulpy orange juice versus non. I still think it's lower compared to the whole fruit. But I think you're still going to get some antioxidants, but more calories. So it would be a trade-off.
Turmeric supplements, are they worthwhile?
Yeah, did I have any research on that? I've got some research on that, on the anti-inflammatory. I think there's a little bit to be careful with turmeric. I believe it's a blood thinner too. So I did go into it a lot because it's not as common. But we can talk about that at the end, or you can take my card on that, yeah.
Yeah, what if you can't use beans? How can you get around that? You can eat one type of bean without having...
It's hard to digest. I mean, you could take like a, there's like a enzymes to help break things down, but beans aren't for everybody, but it's the fiber that's important, and the, so eating the fish to get the protein, quinoa and chia are seeds that both are, you know, whole grains and seeds that both have lots of fiber in it, so there's ways around it. Green peas, I don't know if that's considered, it's not a, like, well, it's kind of a legume, yeah. That is another way of, getting some of the nutrition in there too. I'll see what Katie.
We just have a comment in the back, real quick.
Yeah.
My pharmacist, I called on the turmeric and I asked if it would interfere with anything that I was taking, and she said that this is a red flag on a particular blood pressure medicine, so you really need to check with your pharmacist.
Absolutely.
Or your doctor for those.
Yeah, and that's why I was careful about that with that one. Yeah, thank you.
I have a question, a couple questions right here.
Well, I'm wondering about watermelon.
High in lycopene, I can tell you that off the top of my head. Just if it's good for you.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, it's high in lycopene, which is awesome for you. So, yes, eat your watermelon.
Another question?
My turn. Okay. Would you comment regarding green tea, caffeinated versus decaffeinated? It is caffeinated, right?
Yeah. There's a little bit of caffeine in green tea. A lot less than coffee. You know, the kind of brand that I like, it doesn't come in decaf, but I've tried decaf green tea. It's good, too. I'm always a fan of, like, you don't need the caffeine, don't do it. But it's significantly less than coffee. So it's kind of a personal choice, I think.
As I was reading through this diet, and I was thinking nobody else would want to be in the house with me in the evening.
Because of the beans and the broccoli.
Well, I can't eat broccoli anyway, but the beans and the eggs have a profound effect. Which everybody's giggling, they know what I'm talking about. How do you, if we ate this way, this would be, say, a rather noisome environment.
Well, yeah, like you said, I don't know much about beano, but there is stuff like that. It's probably introducing it to your body slowly, too. I think you probably would have more of a tolerance. But maybe you're going to be better off with peas. You know, maybe you're going to do more nuts. Maybe you're going to focus on quinoa. You're going to add some chia. You know, other ways, you know, it's not worth giving up for that, but I see your point that I would be careful. But maybe kind of get yourself, like I mentioned, you're not just, you know, a tablespoon of black beans in something that you're doing. See if you can build a little bit of a tolerance, but maybe not. Maybe you just aren't going to be a bean person and it just causes... And that's not uncommon. So you would just avoid that. I don't know of any other way around it unless you tried... you could figure out if it was the yolk versus the white, you know, or something like that. Just get protein from, if you do, I mean, beans or hummus and stuff. So, yeah, you'd have to find, like, a whole grain or something that would give you some protein.
I got a question back here. What about good old cod liver oil?
Well, cod liver is going to have the fish oil in it. It also has, I believe, a lot of vitamin A. There's something, or the E. I'm so sorry, I can't remember off the top of my head. So it's similar, but it's higher dose of fat-soluble vitamins, which I can't get. I think it's A or E. I'll have to look it up. It's a blood thinner. Good. Yeah, I know. It's in the correct dose and being managed, and if you're not on any other high risk if you're not any other blood thinners or have any conditions that would make you more susceptible, it's probably okay, but you should really kind of talk with a pharmacist, your doctor, and know what the dose is you're looking for.
We all grew up with cod liver.
Yeah. Horrible. The taste. Well, now they make it lemon flavored, so.
I got a question back here. I'll be up towards the front just a second. Basically, just a comment. Pomegranate juice interacts with high blood pressure medications.
Yeah. It can. You got to be careful. Just like the grapefruit. Yep.
What about raw honey, cider vinegar, and water?
People swear by using, like, you're talking about, like, Bragg's or one of the natural cider vinegars. You know, they swear for digestion, for, and the raw honey has natural anti-allergy and just other things. I don't know of anything wrong with that if you can tolerate it. It's acidic, but some people say it actually helps with their digestion and things. So, you know, you don't want to, you would never want to drink vinegar. So you're talking about, we're talking about vinegar, right? You said without being diluted in something because of your teeth. And it's strong on your whole digestive system. But if it was in water or something, I don't know of a big, we eat vinegar and a lot of other things like salad dressings and stuff, so I don't have a personal huge problem, and some people think it makes them feel better, so they can both be good things in moderation.
I have two questions. On the beans, would green beans be?
Not really, they're not really legumes, yeah. No. I like green beans, that's fiber though, they're excellent, but not for that purpose.
Second question, I saw an article mentioning tart cherry juice.
That's another huge, like cherries in general, huge antioxidants. Yep, that, those are the anthocyanins or whatever they're called.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yeah. How important is it to choose organic?
Well, that is a person. I'm going to say just. I think organic is a personal thing. I think getting enough fruits and vegetables is number one, whether they're conventional or organic. It's a really hard thing. We're not 100% sure. We've got our some people put out lists of things that are more highly contaminated. Those can also be, people say those aren't 100% accurate. There's so much cross-contamination in fields. So, you know, I think number one, get these healthy foods in. Get rid of the processed stuff. If you can afford and you feel strongly about doing certain things that are organic, I certainly don't think it's unhealthy. Fresh is best. I'm thinking farmer's market, instead of having organic that's been in a truck for 2 weeks, you know, with the quality and the nutrients. So I just don't think it's a cut and dry answer. I'm sorry. I support people either way on it. I don't think there's a right and a wrong. I think certain things that probably, you know, but the research is changing on, you know, lettuce and stuff like that. So wash everything really good and consider it if it's something that is part of your belief system and you can afford it.
I think we got one last question here in the back.
How about beer?
I think beer is a good fermented product. Yeah. I wish I could say it was part of the Mediterranean diet. It's a grain, right? So.
Why, yes.
Moderation.
Yeah. Let's give Emily a round of applause. Thank you.